Okay, good morning everyone. Welcome to the first meeting of the Local Government Communities Committee in 2017. Can I wish everyone a happy new year? Hope they're refreshed from their festive break. And can I remind everyone present, as always, to turn off mobile phones, but also as members' papers are provided in a digital format, you may see some members using tablets during the course of the meeting, so that's what they're doing. No apology been received for this morning's meeting. I will move straight to agenda item one, which is decision on taking business in private. The committee is invited to agree to take agenda items 7 and 8, consideration of draft reports on draft budget scrutiny 2017-18 and payments to returning officers in private. Are we agreed? Okay, thank you for that. We now move to agenda item 2, Scottish Housing Regulator Annual Report and Accounts 2015-2016. So at agenda item 2, the committee will take evidence from the Scottish Housing Regulator on its annual report and accounts 2015-16. And we welcome this morning Kay Blair, Chair. Thank you for coming along, Kay. And Michael Cameron, Chief Executive, Scottish Housing Regulator. Kay, can I invite you to make a brief opening statement to the committee?
Yes, indeed. And good morning, everyone. Thank you for giving us this further opportunity to present our work to the committee. As I've said previously to the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee, we welcome parliamentary scrutiny of our work. We are a listening organisation, we're keen to heed feedback, and wherever possible, we're keen to act on that feedback and reflect these views and how we regulate. I'm delighted to be able to present our annual report and accounts, which we laid before Parliament in September. I'm also here to answer any questions, along with Michael, Chief Executive, any questions that the committee may have on our work in the annual report or indeed up to date. Our annual report highlights our work to protect the interests of tenants, of homeless people and of other customers of social landlord services. We've had a continued focus since we started on good governance, on financial health and good service delivery. And many of these are intertwined when we actually come to look at organisations. It's not just a financial health issue that we're looking at, it's across the board. I have to say, I'm very proud to say that we met all of our objectives in 15-16. We were within budget and we delivered, we believe, good outcomes for tenants and others. We also, very importantly, gave lenders confidence about the housing sector, and that's a very important role that we play. During 15-16, we brought accessible new information on landlord performance to tenants and landlords. This is mostly through the charter that I'm sure you will have seen and hopefully used. We published an individual performance report last year for every landlord, and our national report on the charter showed landlords performing well overall. I have to say, I think that this is a good sector overall. There are some inconsistencies in that, but overall it's strong and it's healthy. And I think that's really important in terms of the housing targets that have been set for new homes, to have a sector that is strong, that has the confidence of the lenders. As part of our digital transformation, we provided tenants with even more performance information that helps them to compare their landlord. It's really important that they're not just looking at their own landlord, but they can look at other landlords that are similar, are in the area, and see how they perform, what their tenants think of them, how they engage with their tenants, and that's really important. I've been told to keep this short, so I will do, and I'm coming to the end, you'll be pleased to know. We did have to use our statutory powers, which we haven't done before, in a small number of landlords. We did this proportionately, but decisively, to protect tenants' interests. We only intervened when we could not get the necessary assurance from the registered social landlords that they were able or willing to resolve their problems on their own. Poor governance, again, was at the root of the problems in each of the four cases. And by governance, I'm talking about good leadership, good management, and good implementation of services. I'm pleased to tell you now that we've ended our statutory intervention in two of the organisations after they had successfully resolved the main problems that they faced. Safeguarding and promoting the interests of tenants and other customers drives everything that we do. And we know from feedback we have, we're very proud of our 500-strong national panel of tenants, other homeless people and other customers of the services. And we have a tenant panel that we regularly engage with to give us feedback. They tell us that rent affordability and value for money are absolutely top of their agenda. So we're obviously keeping a real focus on these areas going forward. That ends my opening statement. I'd be delighted, as would Michael, to answer any questions, and I'm sure you do have questions. So over to you.
Thank you very much. That was very helpful, and we'll move straight to our first question. Graham Simpson, MSP.
You refer in your report to a cut in your budget, which I think is 10%. It goes from 4.1 million to 3.7. So given what you've just said about the potential sort of increase in work that is facing you down the line, how is that cut in budget going to affect the service that you provide?
I think that's a very pertinent question. I think we have been concerned about our budget. We have increased demand, we have and really reduced resources. We've gone down from about 79 people about 5 years ago to just over 50 now, with a budget of 3.7 million. We've suffered 40% cuts in costs over that time. But it has made us work smarter. It's given us an opportunity to reassess our priorities, to reassess our focus. And this year we were very fortunate in that we actually got a small increase in our budget. I think because the messages about the value that we add to the sector and the confidence that we give lenders is absolutely critical in this. And I think we estimate that we save the sector, we save about 40 million in reduced borrowing costs in lower interest rates to the sector. And this is what they tell us. Michael, do you want to say anything else on that?
No, other than perhaps to say that we are extremely grateful for the proposed increase in our budget in the next financial year to 3.8. That will certainly help us in our work to maintain effective regulation. It's still challenging in the context of the overall budget settlement for any public body to continue to deliver effectively and efficiently, but that's certainly the objective that we'll set out with.
Okay, that's interesting.
Follow up on that, Mr. Simpson?
I had a slightly different question, which I can ask now or later.
We'll take it a little bit later, if that's okay. I think we'll meet Ruth McGuire next. Ruth?
Convener, good morning. Thanks for being here. In your annual report, you state that the operating environment for social landlord is characterised by new demands, new and increasing risks, new uncertainties and new opportunities. Can you expand a bit more on what those are?
Michael?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's safe to say that the social housing sector faces a range of challenges and potential risks, and that it's a very different operating environment they face than the one they did perhaps 5, 6, 7 years ago. We see a range of challenges. One of the most obvious is them stepping up to the target that the Scottish Government set to deliver around 35,000 new homes for social renting over the next few years. That brings a range of opportunities, challenges and risks. Many landlords are considering to get back into building houses. That brings financial challenges, financial risks. There are risks out there. Our directors routinely talk about a range of different risks that landlords face, from the wider economic environment, there's probably not a conversation that goes by in this particular building, I think, without some reference to Brexit. There are challenges that are faced by landlords around some of the implications that will come from Brexit. We are looking at both finance and people risks there for landlords. So there's quite an array of challenges and risks for social landlords. We every year review those risks, seek to understand how each landlord is placed to handle those kind of risks, and then we form our engagement with those landlords in accordance with that annual risk assessment.
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, I was interested to hear how what sort of specific things you'd be doing to help the landlords operate effectively. I suppose, I mean, as you brought it up, Brexit, you talked about financial and people risks around that. Could you speak a bit more about that?
Yeah, and the people risks, I think, can perhaps take some time to play out, but we're conscious that many social landlords rely on labour that is provided by EU nationals. Many landlords will have EU nationals residing in their homes. And there's a range of uncertainty then around both the availability of labour to social landlords and also the potential impact on those social landlords of people either not remaining in those homes or not being able to avail themselves of the same kind of support that's available from the state. So there's a range of uncertainties there. Obviously, the implications around the UK leaving the EU are affecting the finance markets. And we're also seeing some cost pressures already emerging in terms of particularly around materials for the construction of new houses. The supply chain, we're seeing cost pressures building there. Principally at this point is a consequence of the impact on the pound and the exchange rate.
And what's the regulator doing to support landlords through this?
Well, it's actually not our role to support landlords. Our role is to ensure that landlords protect the interests of tenants and other customers. What we do is we through our risk assessment, we identify and publish the range of risks that we think are there. We encourage landlords to consider those themselves and to reflect on their business plans. To ensure that they're accommodating those kind of risks. And we also put out guidance around business planning for social landlords to ensure that they're best placed to respond to the type of risks and challenges that they face.
Thank you. Thanks.
Could I just add?
Yes, of course, Kate Blair. Yeah.
Very briefly to that. I think that there are real risks now that are growing in the sector. I think capacity is an issue, both within the organisations themselves, but just general capacity in terms of new house building. I think the skills, as Michael referred to, have diminished, and so that's an issue that's got to be faced. But I think because we are risk-based and proportionate, we do identify where we think the most serious harms might occur or where there are serious weaknesses and try as much as possible to work with the organisations to get them to rectify the situation. In terms of risk, though, I think that rent affordability is a key risk in the sector. I think you have increasing costs for landlords, but in terms of tenants' income, that does not rise at the same proportion, and I think tenants are very concerned about how they will afford to pay their rent.
Okay.
Thank you.
Do you want to add anything, Ruth McGuire?
No, that's fine. Thank you.
Alexander Schurtner wanted to follow up on some of that.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Thank you for the comments on the uncertainty and risk that they face. But from sometimes uncertainty, there is also opportunity. and potential for it to go forward and develop. What opportunity do you see coming forward in this turbulent time that we face? And also, what role do you see the Scottish Government has? Is there an increased role for the Scottish Government to support in the way that we go forward to try to mitigate some of the risks and uncertainty that you have? Or do you think that there are other organisations and individuals that you need to try and communicate with and develop another relationship as you go through this uncertain time?
I think it's absolutely key that Scottish Government engages and understands the opportunities, as you say, as well as the challenges. And there are opportunities. There are opportunities for shared services, for instance. There are opportunities to look at value for money. So I think in terms of it's not all in doom, there's lots of good things on the horizon.
I think safe to say that social landlords over the last 30 to 40 years have been amongst the most innovative and responsive organisations in Scotland in terms of dealing with changing environments and challenges. And I think that's a real strength in the sector. I think their place as community anchors and hubs for services present a real opportunity. There are challenges within that too in terms of the potential for withdrawal of other services in local environment in local communities and social landlords being viewed as the kind of almost the last organisation standing, and that brings some real challenges. But I think there are opportunities in there too, and I think the sector has risen to opportunities in the past. I think supporting them, as the Scottish Government's currently proposing to do with increased funding to support new build, is hugely important. And also picking up in Kay's theme, I think a clear focus on effective cost control, value for money, will be critical to that.
I think that the whole idea of shared services gives us a great chance to see what can be done. And are there any areas that you've looked at that others may have done in other parts of the country or other parts of Europe or elsewhere that they've taken on board some of these opportunities and tried to manage them to benefit the social landlords and organisations like yourself who are trying to support as they go forward?
I think in terms of support to the sector, I think there's a role for the trade bodies in terms of being proactive and giving help, sharing best practice. I think that would be helpful. I think already there's quite a lot taking place in terms of sharing services and looking at how they can do things better. So I think that is happening. And I think they are taking note of what's going on elsewhere.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you, Alexander. Can I just pick up on a couple of things you mentioned, Ms. Blair, when you were answering Ruth Maguire. You mentioned, I don't know if it was in relation to Brexit or in relation to, I think it might have been in relation to getting back in the game for new build social housing with a significant budget over the next 5 years. You mentioned skills, and I wasn't sure if you were talking about skills in the construction sector or skills of senior managers and housing associations perhaps haven't project managed for a while in relation to new build developments. I'm just wondering if we could tease out a little bit more about the challenges over skills.
I'm talking about both. I think around governing bodies, they have to assure themselves that they have the necessary skills within that organisation to develop as they want to. I think some of the past issues that have arisen for us have been because the organisation hasn't actually understood what it's got into, and then has got into some difficulties because of that. So it's essential that they have the skills to understand the complexity and also to understand what they don't know so that they can actually bring in some expertise from elsewhere. I think certainly in seminars and various briefings we've had, there are skill capacities too in the housing sector itself, in terms of building skills, development skills. I believe that if you're a development officer at the moment in Scotland in terms of housing and construction, that you're actually in strong demand. So a good career opportunity probably beckons.
That's helpful. I'm also just kind of wondering in terms of if you're a small social landlord or small to medium social landlord, maybe you've got 800-900 units, maybe there's a small gap site in the area and you're thinking, I might speak to government or the local authority about getting some HAG money for this, maybe 40 or 50 units, but look, it's been 10 years since we've built anything. And you've got to tie up that lending from the banks, you've got to do your 25-year projections, you've got to deal with construction companies or procurement processes. That's the skills I was thinking maybe that are not as active as they have been in the past. Yeah. Would the housing regulator have a role in relation to that process of support, or would have a role in terms of the sign off on any business plans, or would it be a role of looking back and seeing how the sector performed? Where would the housing regulator sit within that mix?
We don't give advice, but in terms of business plans, every year we look at the business plans of the organisation, look at the complexity, look at the scope of what they're doing, to give us assurance that they actually know what they're doing. Because again, some of the areas that people have got into trouble has been when they haven't known enough about what they're doing and what they're expanding into. What we have found is that the sector is very diverse. And that's one of its attractions, because it is so diverse. But that does have challenges as well in terms of, as you say, some very small organisations which have actually decided not to develop, but just to manage their properties.
Yeah. Mr Cameron, did you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I mean, many associations are already collaborating with other organisations that have the kind of skills that you talked about. It's not always the case that even where an organisation is developing properties to own and let, that they will necessarily undertake all the work themselves. And the sector's quite well developed in terms of its approaches to sharing those types of services. But it's certainly a risk that we've identified, that given that there has been a reduction in the delivery over a period of time by a range of organisations that now want to get back into it, that they need to be, as Kay says, ensuring that they've got the right skills at board committee level, within their own staff, both in terms of the process of developing new houses, but also the kind of finance skills that might be required to support that, and then ensuring that there's appropriate skills and capacity in the supply chain to be able to deliver effectively.
And the role of the regulator, and Kay Blair, you mentioned it's not the regulator's position to look at business plans and that kind of thing, but would it be a retrospective role the regulator would have to say, maybe look back at developments over the last 5 years and see what lessons could be learned for the social rented sector? Is that the kind of thing you would do?
We do look at business plans. That's part of our risk assessment.
For new developments? About you look at business plans in the round.
Yes.
Would you look at business plans going forward for any new developments in isolation or in the round as part of the overall package?
In the round, really.
At the moment, there's a number of ways in which we might become involved in that. As Kay says, each year we will look at the organisation's overall business plan, which will include its proposed future developments and new build projects. So we'll look at that in the totality of the organisation's finances to understand the impact. At the moment, we have a role where an organisation is seeking to borrow money to build houses, and as part of that they'll be looking to dispose of some assets by way of standard security, and they would require our consent to do that. And that's very common where there's a new build development happening, that's part of it, and that we would therefore have a look at the whole proposal in that regard. But our role is principally to look at the overall finances of the organisation and ensure that any of its proposed business developments don't adversely impact on the interests of tenants over the longer term.
Okay, that's helpful. Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to ask a question about homelessness, but before I do, I just want to pick up the answers you gave to Ruth Maguire's earlier question. Do your the risks and uncertainties and opportunities you talk about apply equally to local government as they do to community-based housing associations?
We have a different way of scrutinising local government, local authorities, in terms of we have a shared risk assessment, so there are other regulators that we work with, and we really look at service delivery, so that's quite different in terms of we don't look at the financial or governance situation, we only look at service delivery for local authorities. So it's shared scrutiny.
Okay, so do you say anything in your annual report about that shared scrutiny of local government?
Yes, we do. I can't remember what page it's in. But what have we found? In terms of our charter, we've found that local authorities are doing well in terms of tenant satisfaction. They are slightly below the satisfaction levels that RSLs achieve, but that's often to do with the context in which they are operating. But it is improving. Okay. And that's really important. And now we can benchmark that information because we have enough information from the charter to see where the improvements are and to compare. And that's been a real catalyst for improving standards.
Excellent. Just move on to ask a question about homelessness. You report a 4% drop in homelessness. That's perhaps not statistically significant. Do you have a view on the state of homelessness, the contribution that the housing options approach is making to tackling homelessness?
We're very concerned about homelessness. I know that the numbers are down in terms of applications, but if you just need to look at the streets and people sleeping rough to know that there is a real problem, and it's a very complex problem. It's not just providing somebody with a house, it's providing most of the homeless people with a package of health and well-being that takes into account more than just a house. But we are concerned that there are too many people who are homeless, and we are going to focus on that this year. Housing options we looked at, government produced guidance around it, and we have to look at that in more depth this year, and it's one of our tasks.
Yeah, I think it's, to echo what Kay said, it will remain a key area of focus for us over the next year and probably beyond. It's the single biggest issue that we engage with local authorities around. You referenced the Housing Options Report, which we published back in 2014, with a very clear recommendation to the Scottish Government that there was a need for guidance for local authorities around the implementation of housing options. That guidance was put in place last year, so we will revisit housing options to ensure that that guidance is being appropriately adhered to and implemented.
Okay, that's very welcome. I've just got a second question, and that's on your annual report that highlights that there's room for improvement in the services to gypsy travellers. Mm-hmm. Can you say something about that and perhaps what you intend to do in the year ahead?
Again, this is a concern for us. Our report shows clearly that gypsy travellers do not have the same satisfaction levels as other tenants in housing. This is the first time that we've really got full data. We're looking at this in more depth now to find out what the particular sites that have the most problems are doing about it. We also have, and I'm very pleased to say, we have gypsy travellers on our panel, of our national panel, and that's been really helpful in giving us feedback that's what's important to them. And again, rent is key, and the quality of the site, key factors for them. But it is a concern, but we are focusing on it this year again.
You'll be aware that last year the Scottish Government published minimum standards for gypsy traveller sites, and that will be incorporated into the charter from this April onwards. So that will become an important focus for us in our future plans around scrutiny of landlords' delivery of services to gypsy travellers, and we will be looking to those standards as a benchmark for how those landlords are performing.
Finally, just a very brief point. You earlier said that your staffing levels were now, I think, a little over 50. Your report talks about 48, I think I recall seeing. Average number of persons employed, so that's average number of persons employed over 2014-15. So does that, did your numbers go down and then they're up to above 50, or is that just a ballpark?
They did, and that we went through, and we continue to go through a change exercise to ensure that our resources are appropriately aligned to our priorities. We have turnover, and then we bring new people in. So at the point of the production of that report, that was an accurate figure. We currently have just over 50 people in places in post at the moment. As I was saying earlier, our budget settlement, proposed budget settlement for next year, should enable us to maintain our level round about that figure.
Okay, thank you, convener.
Okay, thank you. Kenneth Gibson. Thank you, convener. Registered social landlords have to meet the energy efficiency standard for social housing by 2020. I'm just wondering what kind of progress is being made towards reaching that.
Yes, as you say, 2020 is the target for the achievement of the energy efficiency standards. We have been monitoring landlords' progress towards that, in the last year, landlords reported to us that just over 68% of all houses that they let and that are within the scope of the standard currently comply with those provisions. The Scottish Government plans to include the energy efficiency standard in the new charter from April. That puts it onto a more formalised footing and gives it that statutory status. And so our monitoring and engagement with landlords will reflect that new status. And we will look to focus on landlords' delivery of the standard up to that target deadline, and we'll publish annual monitoring figures on that.
Thanks very much. I mean, I saw the 68.3% figure, but of course that looks at the 160 registered social landlords. I'm just wondering what the variance is between the landlords. You know, I mean, some might be, you know, some at 30%, some at 90%. Are they all on track to actually meet the target by 2020, or are there difficulties that have to be addressed along the way there? Because obviously we're talking about only 3 years, and there's still quite a number of tenants will be expecting these measures to be put in.
You're quite right when you say that there's a variation in the level of compliance currently, and that's an important factor that we'll take into account in our annual risk assessment, and we'll do that in a similar way to the way that we monitored and engaged with landlords around their delivery of the Scottish Housing Quality Standard and the energy efficiency element within that. So we'll be engaging with any landlord that has further to go than that average suggests as the overall picture, to ensure that they have appropriate plans and resources in place to achieve the standard by the target.
Are you confident, though, that they all will? I mean, because you haven't actually said what the variance is, you know, I'm obviously concerned about if there are any that are there any that are falling behind or that you've got particular worries about? And how does the RSL sector compare with the 32 local authorities? So, In terms of reaching the target?
We do have figures around variance and the comparison between local authorities, and can get that to the committee. Mm-hmm. We will engage with landlords, particularly from April onwards, when the energy efficiency standard becomes that formalised part of the charter. That then brings it very clearly within our remit to look at those landlords. We'll engage with any landlord that we have a concern around in terms of the distance they have to go and the potential capacity issues that they may have. And we'll have a requirement on those landlords to provide us with a clear plan that takes them to that compliance level, and we will then start to monitor and report on their delivery against those plans over the coming years.
Well, That's very positive. I'm pleased to hear that. And how do RSLs and local authorities compare at the moment
We do have those figures too, and I have them here. If you give me a second, I'll get them.
Because obviously there'll be a variance within local authorities as well.
There absolutely is. I have those figures here. That overall figure, the overall average of 68.6%, breaks down to 72.6% for RSLs. That's the number of houses complying with the standard. For local authorities, it's 65.2%.
So it's the local authorities that need to do more to catch up?
They're marginally behind, and at a level that doesn't necessarily surprise me, given the kind of age profile of the stock that sit within the two different areas of the sector.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that, Mr. Cameron. Thank you. Okay, Graham Simpson, did you want back in for a follow-up question?
It was really in relation to the three RSLs that you had to intervene on, and I wonder if you can give us some details on why you had to do that.
We had to do that because we felt, particularly in one, that there was a danger of insolvency. We had to do it because the boards themselves were not taking control of their own situation, and they didn't have the expertise to turn around the situation. Sometimes we met with appreciation and were welcomed to work with the organisation in terms of the statutory intervention. Sometimes it was more difficult and more challenging. Michael, do you want to add?
Yeah, we've now used our statutory intervention powers in four organisations, and as Kay mentioned earlier, we're now being able to end the statutory intervention in two because the organisations had made sufficient progress in improving with the support of the statutory appointees. Kay's mentioned this before. The common thread in all of those organisations was weaknesses in the organisation's governance. That's what led us to have to intervene, particularly when it became clear to us through our engagement with them and our support of the organisation to try and self-improve that the organisations either just didn't have the capacity or the willingness to address the fundamental issues that they faced.
You might be interested in looking at our website because we do have one of the reports on one of these organisations, the first one, and it's quite illuminating as to what the problems were. We're shortly going to be publishing the second one because we're very keen that the sector learns from the mistakes that were made. We're very keen that they take on board some of the messages about, recognising diversity and complexity, making sure you have the skills, making sure you have the funding available. And our concern, and particularly in one of them, was the threat of insolvency had we not taken action.
Which one was that? Which one was that?
That was Muir House Housing Association, and we have concluded our statutory intervention that and published our review report of that intervention. So that's now in the public domain.
And what are the two organisations that you're still involved with?
We are still involved with two organisations. The names that have immediately gone out.
Fergusley Park and Wellhouse,
we've now ended engagement. Right. Fergusley Park and Antonine Housing Associations.
But we haven't published the report on Wellhouse yet. That will be the end of next month, probably.
Hopefully.
Quickly ask if you've created this sort of digital comparison tool. What's the take up on that? I mean, how many people are using that?
We don't have hard and fast figures on how many we do. I have to say, what we do get is very strong anecdotal feedback on the popularity of the tool. We can look at that. We may be able to provide the committee with web page hit type information. We'll get that, and that will give you a sense of the level of usage of the tool. But certainly from the feedback we get from tenants, from our tenants panel, and indeed from landlords, it seems to have been a popular addition to the range of tools that are available for people.
Okay. Thanks, Convener.
Okay. We're drawing towards the end of our evidence session. There's one thing I want to follow up with Kay Blair on. Earlier on in questioning, you mentioned challenges around tenants' income, and it made me think about tenant arrears and how that's managed by registered social landlords. So I'm just wondering if there's any kind of general comments in relation to tenant arrears, some of the causes behind that. And I'm also interested in what local, maybe constituency reason for asking this, but I'll keep it fairly general, about the link between policies in relation to housing investment that some social landlords may have in their stock and how they may or may not invest in individual properties who have housing arrears, sometimes quite small levels of housing arrears, that they may actually miss out on stock investments. I'll leave that bit hanging there. It's more about the level of tenant arrears, the issues for housing associations and, you know, local authorities as well, and whether there should be any consequences in terms of the level of investment to properties during an investment programme, for example. What should the consequences be?
I think in terms of arrears, it's an area that we do look at, that we are obviously keeping a focus on. We have issued in the past some publications about managing arrears and landlords being sympathetic to tenants' cases where they do get into trouble and can't pay their rent. We are concerned, but nothing has really... nothing is escalating at the moment, but it's something we will obviously keep an eye on, because we are aware that costs are going up in these organisations, but income tenants' income is not likely to go up in the same way, so it will not be proportionate. In terms of the second question about investing in current...
clarity around it. My apologies, I conflated two questions there. So I've got experience of a registered social landlord choosing not to do investment programme work, for example, a new kitchen, a new bathroom, and missing out some of the houses that are in rent arrears, but investing in the other houses because that was part of a local policy. And I had significant issues with that, and I corresponded and I think got a result for the constituent in question. But I'm just wondering, I didn't really want to single out that one registered social landlord. I've been careful not to actually name them. Yeah. It's more about the link between how local authorities or registered social landlords seek to take action to focus minds in rent arrears and what the consequences are for some quite vulnerable tenants at times. And that was one example that I thought was deeply unsatisfactory. So any reflections on that would be quite helpful.
In terms of decisions to be made around investment, we would expect landlords to not take account of the individual tenant circumstances, as you've described. We're aware that there are a number of different incentive schemes that landlords can operate to encourage full payment of rent. But we would absolutely be interested in any landlord that was taking an approach that sought to penalise any tenant who was in arrears in terms of investment.
That's helpful. I've deliberately not named them. We'll correspond separately in relation to that. But I was just wondering if there was a general theme of that happening that you were aware of across the board, or other unintended consequences in relation to rent arrears. Thank you very much. Some of my MSP colleagues do want back in, but we have run out of time, I'm afraid, but there's always time at the very end of an evidence session to allow either of both of you to make any final remarks or comments you may want before we move on to the next item on the agenda.
No, I would just like to say thank you very much again for inviting us here. I think we have had a good year as a regulator. We are concerned about the economic situation, about the impact of Brexit, about inflation and value for money, rent affordability. These are issues that all concern us. We have to maintain the confidence of lenders in the sector. We think there are exciting opportunities, but obviously big risks, and we're very keen that the sector identifies and mitigates these risks wherever it can.
Okay.
But thank you very much.
Well, Mr. Cameron, Ms. Blair, thank you very much for your evidence. That concludes agenda item 2, and we'll suspend briefly to allow us to prep for agenda item 3. Thank you, both of you. Welcome back, and we move to agenda item 3, Scottish Public Sector Ombudsman Annual Report 2015-16. At agenda item 3, the committee will take evidence from the Scottish Public Sector Ombudsman on his annual report 2015-16. And can I welcome Jim Martin, the Ombudsman? Good morning. Accompanied by Nicky McLean, Director. Good morning, Nicky. And John Stevenson, Head of Complaint Standards, Scottish Public Services Ombudsman. Good morning, John. No opening statement has been indicated, so we'll move straight to questions. Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everyone. I'm interested to hear more about your new responsibilities around the Scottish Welfare Fund. Now, you touched on that in the briefing note that was helpfully sent to the committee, and I do understand there's going to be a full report coming, but I'd just like to hear your reflections on your experiences to date, probably particularly around caseload.
First thing to say, Convener, is that the transition to bringing the responsibilities for the Welfare Fund into the Ombudsman's office appears to have gone very smoothly. We seem to have got the confidence of the local authority sector and the third sector for the way that we've approached it and the way we've brought things in. I'm going to ask Nicky McLean to go over the details of the work we've done so far, but I have a caveat, and that is we're only 6 months into our first year of dealing with it. There will always be issues about a full year and how to look at numbers there. And also, I mean, there are also wrinkles that have to be ironed out in the first year of any operation. But
So in terms of volumes and timescales, people will be aware that the crisis grants have to be dealt with within one day and 21 days for community care grants. So in terms of our performance to date, we're achieving those timescales in pretty much every case, and that compares quite favourably in comparison to the previous local authority second tier stage performance. So I think in terms of our ability to process this work within the statutory deadlines, we're meeting that very comfortably at the moment. I think one of the significant benefits of the system that we're operating at the moment is that it is very easily accessible. We take these cases over the telephone. I think that that is working very well for applicants. In terms of volumes, we've dealt with around 175 decisions so far. I think the one change, it is very early days. I think we're in month 9, month 10 now. So it is very early days, but one of the changes that we have seen is that the split between crisis and community care grants has altered compared to last year. So at the moment, it's around a 50% split between the two types of grant. It's difficult to say if that is an ongoing trend, but previously there were a much higher number of community care grants and much lower number of crisis grants.
Thank you, Convener. Your experience of working with the local authorities on that, and I suppose particularly around the crisis grants, you said that you felt you have the confidence of them and it's working well. Can you just tell us a bit more about that?
So I think I referred to confidence in our ability to process these applications. I think that broadly speaking, we are working well with local authorities. I think that one of the benefits, the perceived benefits of this system would be that we were independent. And I think that that is bearing fruit in the sense that I think that we can offer advice, guidance, direction to local authorities around the level, particularly the level of information they provide to applicants when they're reaching decisions. We're seeing some requirement for additional explanation and information to applicants when they're being either awarded or denied these grants. So I think that is where our expertise will really benefit.
I think one of the early concerns that was expressed to us in the extensive consultation we did before we brought it on was whether we would be imposing a national standard on local authorities. And what we have always said is that what we want to achieve is not that, but a consistency of approach so that everyone understands where they are and that the rules apply consistently. And we haven't had any challenges yet, you know, to suggest that there's any inconsistencies that people have found. So to that regard, the intention of having a single Scottish protocol for these things appears to be working. But as I say, as Nikki says, it's month 9 or something, so we've got a long way to go.
Thank you.
That's fine. I know Kenneth Gibbs wants to follow up on some of that.
Yeah, thanks very much,
Convener. Good morning. I mean, in following on from Ruth Maguire's questions, in terms of page 7 of your submission, you talk about since the 1st of April 2016, SPSO has the ability to make binding decisions in relation to Scottish Welfare Fund review cases. And I think that's very welcome, but you also express, I feel in your paper, an element of frustration that you're not able to make binding recommendations in specific limited circumstances elsewhere, and you've pointed out again under 3.4 the third paragraph there that an organisation didn't want to implement a recommendation could simply ignore it, and this seems to me inherently unfair. Although you've got it further down the page, I wonder if you can just expand a wee bit more on what you feel should be done about that.
I know this must be an important item, Convener, because I see it in the Times this morning, so. It must be important. Let me share my frustration. I've been Ombudsman for 8 years, so this is the last time I'll be before a committee like this with an annual report. And consistently over that 7-8 years, I have said that I did not see a reason for the Ombudsman to have binding powers. And the reason for that is that the recommendations made by the Ombudsman are, sometimes with a bit of persuasion, but invariably carried through. In the last 2 years, I would say, there's been a sea change in the attitude of some public bodies towards our recommendations. And I think that whoever succeeds me as Ombudsman is going to have some kind of extra power in their armoury to ensure that recommendations are carried forward. The point I'm trying to make in the submission to you is that once we make a recommendation, there is no power that I have to ensure that that recommendation is carried out other than persuasion and the threat of public exposure. And one occasion recently, I've had the chair of an organisation say to me, so what, Jim? So what are you going to do? You know? And I said, well, I'll take it to Parliament. So that's great, Jim. You've been to Parliament. They don't even have a process for dealing with your special reports. You asked them to have it, and they said no. So what's the big deal? In the case that you've referred to, which may well come to Parliament in the excitingly named other report provision that I have, which has never been used either since 2002, we have a particular local authority in Scotland who agreed to a recommendation which involved giving recompense to someone who was out of pocket, and 18 months to 2 years later is still not carrying out that recommendation and is finding lots of obstacles to put in the way. In my view, at that point, or at some point along that process, the Ombudsman should have some kind of power in order to make that happen. Now, if I'm a private individual, a citizen coming to the Ombudsman, my recourse is judicial review. And that, I think, is a big, big step. It's very expensive, very difficult to achieve. For a public body, the route, if you do not want to comply with an Ombudsman recommendation, is to ignore it. And at the moment, there's very little that can be done. Now, what I'm not arguing for is binding recommendations in all matters from the Ombudsman, because I do believe that the recommendations being implemented through partnership and through a sense of doing the right thing is the way to go. And it works for every other Ombudsman in the United Kingdom. I think that's the right way. What I am saying is that in those few cases where my successor may find that they have got authorities who simply want to ignore the power or to say that the Ombudsman really has no power, there has to be something in the armoury to back that up.
I mean, I share, Jim, your concerns and frustrations, and I note that alarmingly, in the second paragraph, 3.4, you end that paragraph by saying, most significantly, the organisation's obstruction has delayed justice, and I think that's clearly an issue that could be addressed. But you talked about a sea change with public bodies. I mean, you're sitting here at a parliamentary committee. Why don't you name and shame these organisations who are just blanking you when a recommendation has been made? I mean, this is your last year. As Ombudsman, go out in a blaze of glory. Come on, let's name and shame some of these people. Because, I mean, why not if we're trying to get, as you have said in your report, justice?
For that invitation to rant.
I'm sure you won't.
One of the problems I think we have in the public sector in Scotland is there seems to be a view abroad that naming and shaming leads to improvement. It doesn't. Naming and shaming leads to defensive cultures in public bodies. It means that officials are less keen to be transparent. It means that decisions which are taken which are wrong are often defended to the nth degree. I've, over the last 8 or 9 years, dealt with chief executives. I'll give you one example of a chief executive at a health board who asked me not to lay a report before Parliament, but to issue a decision letter, because if the decision is a report to Parliament, there'll be more publicity, more damage to the authority, that kind of thing. What we have found is by working alongside public bodies to generate a culture of improvement and learning from things that have gone wrong, things change, things improve. So I would caution against the naming and shaming culture. Can I give a second reason for that, which is anecdotal? I was having a conversation last week or the week before with some colleagues who are pretty senior in private sector business. And I was trying to encourage them to think about bringing their skills and their talents into the public sector. The most common thing they said to me was, why the hell would we put ourselves through that? Because if you all we see, Jim, is you going before committees and committees wanting to name, to shame, to pillory. And I think in Scotland, we really need to get past that culture. We need to embrace a culture which is designed to certainly be transparent, but also to engender improvement. Thanks for the rant, convener.
was there a rant?
No, I don't think it was a rant, sorry. And I have to say, I had a case, it wasn't involving yourselves, but it was a financial ombudsman who had awarded £186,000 to a constituent of mine, and the organisation, point blank, after 2 years, refused to pay this retired individual a penny. And I basically said to them, I'm sorry, if you don't pay up, I will name and shame you. And they wrote the cheque within a couple of weeks. So I think it depends. Maybe public bodies might think differently from private bodies. But if you're being blanked year in, year out, surely there is an issue where the person who's came to you for your assistance would want that, because they would want justice. Now, I know you're making recommendations in terms of, having binding decisions in certain circumstances, but for that individual where you have said justice has been delayed, what are they supposed to do if there's no naming and shaming, the organisation say no, and at this point there is no binding power? You can understand how that person must feel in such circumstances.
I do, and that convener is exactly why I'm asking for the power to be given that I'm talking about. Because the problem there is not that you're not naming and shaming the organisation. The problem there is that the organisation has got no one telling them that they must do that. And what I'm saying, if we got to a situation like that in the public sector, then I think you must trust whoever is sitting in the ombudsman seat to use that power appropriately, but give them that power to make sure that people who do not want to carry through judgments, decisions and recommendations do that.
Thank you. Thanks, Kimbia.
Tease some of that was really helpful in a question, Mr. Gibson. Can we just tease some of that out? Because you've said that you don't really have many weapons, if any, in your armoury at all in terms of making decisions binding and enforcing compliance, but you don't want to name and shame. And you're saying, Mr. Martin, that perhaps in some circumstances, some decisions should be binding. Can you be a bit clearer in relation to when decisions should be binding or what other additional powers that you would like?
Sure. I think I've set out in the paper that where a decision is reached where an organisation does not intend to challenge that decision in the court, but also that organisation shows no intention of actually carrying out that decision and its recommendations, at that point, the Ombudsman should have the power to say this recommendation is now binding. You must remember, we can get past naming and shaming, right? We were the first Ombudsman office in the United Kingdom, and Parliament was the first to understand the need for this, to give us the ability to publish our decisions. So we publish our decisions in summary form, and we do it to protect the anonymity of the people who have brought the complaints, and sometimes the professionals at the centre of it. By doing that, every month I publish 60 to 70 decisions, and in most of these decisions, 95% of them will name the health board or the local authority or the housing association or the prison or whatever it is. So that is in the public domain. What I don't want to do is, well, we're in the process of investigating or in the process of trying to get a recommendation carried out, where Parliament has told me I need to do that in private, and I support that actually. At that, when we're in that process, I don't think it's appropriate to name and shame at that point. But you have given the Ombudsman the power at the end of the process to publish summaries which are anonymised. If I can just shift this on just maybe a wee bit, the other part of what I'm asking for is a common sense application of the use of the information that the Ombudsman has. So that currently, convener, if I have a piece of information as a result of an investigation, which I believe presents a health or safety risk, I can share that information generally with people I think it's appropriate to do so. But there are other organisations who are carrying out investigations where I may have a piece of information which of itself does not meet that high bar, but which I know would assist an investigation, say, by the General Medical Council, the General Dental Council, whoever. At the moment, I'm precluded from sharing that information with them. And every year I get requests from bodies like that and Healthcare Improvement Scotland, for example, for information that I have, which I know would be useful to them, which I cannot share. That seems to me not terribly wise. And I think Parliament might want to give some consideration while protecting the rights of individuals to have their data protected, to enabling the Ombudsman to help other regulators and other bodies to carry out, in the public interest, investigations. Okay. So you see, the whole thing, I think, sits together.
A particular point in relation to this, Mr. Martin, you will shortly, without going Ombudsman, as we know, you'll move on to pastures new, whatever they may be. It's quite difficult for someone in your position when sitting in this post, when you're independent, but you administer the rules and the structures and the statutes as you have been given, and now's an opportunity as you're departing this post to give a lot more clarity into how you would like to see the post develop in the future. Stronger, more binding decisions, not naming and shaming, but real powerful levers that a future Ombudsman could use. Once you're no longer in this post, will you be keen to continue to work with Parliament and government to push some of that forward? Because you'll actually perhaps be in a stronger position to do some of that.
Is that a job offer, convener?
I can't even get myself a job, Mr. Martin. So
I think it's very important. I've held a number of high-profile posts in the past. One time, for example, I was General Secretary of the Educational Institute of Scotland. Most people are too young to remember that time. And I've always taken the view that when you go, you go. What I'm trying to do today, and what I'm giving you today, is a step for a hint that it's perhaps time to revisit what Parliament thought in 2002 and see whether it's relevant in 2016. I could go on forever, but one thing that I think Parliament should be aware of, the SPSO is probably perceived internationally at a higher level than it is in Scotland. I mean, recently the Institute, the Ombudsman Institute, the worldwide body, prepared a paper for the United Nations and for countries who are thinking about setting up an Ombudsman system. And in the course of that, they only mentioned two countries as examples of innovation, South Korea and Scotland. So I think we've together, Parliament and the Ombudsman Office, We've built an evolving and improving Ombudsman service for Scotland, which I think everybody in the rest of the United Kingdom and Ireland are looking at. I would hope that Parliament would encourage my successor to continue with that. But one of the things that I have found frustrating over the period is that it has been difficult to engage with Parliament and with government to some extent on the general powers and direction of the Ombudsman, rather than in meetings like this, which sometimes with your predecessor committee has been quite adversarial. So the approach has been quite rightly about scrutiny and not really about strategic thinking. And I think if the committee wants to think about how it might enable my successor to come and think with you and with government strategically, I think that would be an innovation which would bear a lot of fruit.
To reflect on the evidence we get from this morning's session, and there are a number of other questions other than how reforms may come in that we'll want to ask today. I suppose I was trying to tease out whether this was a parting shot or ongoing dialogue, which was the reason for asking that follow-up question. Jobs are not in my gift, Mr. Martin, I'm afraid, in relation to that. Mr. Simpson, want to follow up on some of that, and then we'll move on to another line of questioning.
Yeah, thank you, convener. I actually think this is quite outrageous. It's not the phrase naming and shaming is not right. It's a matter of accountability. Councils are funded through the public purse. They're accountable, or should be accountable, to the people that pay for them, and that's the taxpayer. It's not a matter of naming and shaming. There's no point in having an ombudsman if you don't have the power to do anything. So I think if people are ignoring your recommendations, we have a right to know who they are. They shouldn't be able to hide behind the cloak of anonymity. I think this is outrageous, absolutely outrageous.
Just to be clear, I've yet to be in a position where a body has not carried out my recommendations. My issue is, it is now taking me quite a bit longer to get authorities to the position where they actually do. And I think that by giving the Ombudsman that extra thing in their armoury, that's important. I think it's also important that the relationship between public bodies and the Ombudsman is looked at very carefully. I mean, I was quite, what's the right word? I was quite surprised by the couple of the submissions to our strategic plan for this year from SOLAS and from SOLAR, from the chief executives group and the local authority and the local authorities and local authority legal group. I floated the idea that because of the resourcing issues which the Ombudsman Office faces, we may look at a different funding model. And one of the things I floated was perhaps some element of polluter pays, so that, you know, if you get more cases coming to the Ombudsman from one local authority, they maybe pay a little more or whatever. I expected debate about that. What I didn't expect was for our chief executives and our heads of legal to respond to that by saying the solution is to charge people for access to the Ombudsman. Now, that in itself I find abhorrent. I do. But I think it speaks to maybe a cultural problem that we have. If the response that we have to austerity, whether we believe it's there or not, if the response that we have to austerity is the punter pays, then I think that's wholly wrong. And if we start putting barriers between our most vulnerable people and the people who have got power over their lives and their services and make it difficult for them to get to the ultimate point where they can resolve that, if we're going down that route, that's not the Scotland I know. So I think, you know, we maybe have to tease some of these things out and make one or two of our fundamental principles very, very clear.
To move on, we'll go down for another question later, Mr. Simpson. We'll move on just now to Andy Whiteman.
Thank you very much, Convener. Welcome you here today. I'm a new MSP, so I'm quickly becoming familiar with constituents who have complaints about various public bodies and your role in that. So I was particularly interested to read in your review about the complaints handling framework and the work you do in advising public bodies to improve it, etc., because I'm not sure if you'd agree, but ultimately we, in an ideal world, we wouldn't have an ombudsman. I mean, there wouldn't be need for that level of complaint. In that sense, it's useful just to track the kind of complaints you're getting and where they're coming from. But I was wondering if you can give a little bit more detail on the public bodies that you've been working with over the time of your office and the extent to which improvements have been made and the extent to which the processes that you've put in place, such as this complaints handling, complaints improvement framework, will contribute to better service delivery for the public.
Since John Stevenson is the architect of much of this, perhaps it'd be best if...
Thank you. Yeah. I think perhaps I should start off by explaining that the model complaints handling procedures that we have developed and implemented include a requirement to report against performance, and they include a set of key performance indicators, which really are, the purpose is twofold. Firstly, it's to allow organisations to understand internally how they're performing end-to-end in terms of managing complaints. And secondly, it's to allow those bodies to start to compare and contrast their performance, to benchmark their performance against other similar organisations. So that's kind of like the first tool that we've developed and are using to try and improve and learn from complaints handling. You'll see in our annual report that one of the issues that we find is that the percentage, the volume of complaints that we uphold is still significantly high. And therefore, while we have model complaints procedures, while the process for claiming for complaining is simple and straightforward for our customers, people using public services in Scotland, we still find that ultimately the decisions that are made by public bodies are often erroneous or flawed or whatever. They come to the Ombudsman's Office and we uphold them. So we've looked at how we can further support public bodies in terms of the decision making. And one of the areas that we have developed, one of the tools that we've developed, is the new complaints improvement framework. And the complaints improvement framework looks at what would an effective complaints handling service look across the organisation. So it identifies six areas of good practice. It allows organisations to self-assess their performance against each of those areas of good practice. And one of the areas of good practice is the issue of quality. and its quality of the investigation process, its quality of the decision, its clarity of the decision when that decision is communicated to the customer. And it focuses very much on conducting a thorough, robust investigation that responds to each and every part of the complaint that has been made so that the body can be assured that they've delivered the final and definitive response to complaints.
Sorry, can I just add something to that, Camille? You're the only committee of a parliament or an assembly in Europe who has access to the information that comes through that process. No other country in Europe has it. You have it, and it's not being used. So, for example, in local government, the Improvement Service manages the network of complaint handlers, gathers the information that they have. There's valuable information there about the performance of local government. We're about to put the social work and the health complaints, complaint handling processes in place as well. So for the first time, this Parliament will be able to see across the whole of the public sector in Scotland, from a complaints perspective, what's working and what's not. I would urge the committee to think about how to use that information, not just to hold, you know, local authorities and others to account, but to spot areas where we maybe collectively can improve the services that we're giving and encourage people to work together towards that improvement. Now, Wales and Northern Ireland are going to have this next year or the year after. England has declined to have it, which is, you know, a bit of a sadness to me, because I'd hoped that we'd persuaded Westminster to do that. But I think you have this resource, and I would encourage the committee to use it.
Can I just follow up on that? The resource that Jim refers to tells us for the last 3 years in Scotland, local authorities have received somewhere in the region of 60,000 complaints per year. And of those 60,000 complaints, on average, they close, they resolve 80%, 80% plus of complaints at stage one, which is within 5 working days. So I think that by any standard, that seems to be a good performance. I think the issue is for those complaints that are not resolved at stage one, for those 15 to 20% or so, and the ones that eventually escalate their way, find their way to come to the Ombudsman's office, it's about the clarity of the decision and the ability for that decision to stand up to scrutiny. But there is lots of valuable information coming out of the local authority sector in terms of their performance. There's lots of good work going on with the local government network group in terms of benchmarking and comparing and contrasting performance for improvement, and we're very encouraged by that. I think the one area that we're seeing that there is room for improvement is that of learning from complaints, which is one of the indicators, and that's far more difficult for the local government sector to demonstrate. So that information is all there, it's all available to you, as Jim says, and I think it is adding value across the sector.
Can I just follow that briefly? You also note in your complaints framework, bit of the report, that the notable differences between the 2 years were a reduction in requests from the local government sector and an increase in requests from NHS. Clearly, local government is accountable formally to local electors through elected members, etc. The NHS obviously is not, it's a national service. And obviously, the nature of the services it provides can lead to people with very, very, very serious complaints. Is this increase in requests from the NHS for advice and support, I should say, do you think that's a result? Why do you think that's happening? Do you think that's just an additional increasing pressures they're feeling?
I think there's possibly two issues there. First of all, we'd expect over a period of time to see the requests for advice and guidance and support from the local government sector to decrease, because we now have 3-4 years experience of operating the model complaints procedure. We have the network, which is a great source of identifying and sharing good practice. So it seems reasonable to me that over a period of time, the need to come to the Ombudsman's office for advice and guidance in relation to complaints handling would diminish. Up until very recently, the NHS complaints procedure was different from the models that apply across Scotland. We've been doing a lot of work recently, and in fact, we led the development of a new NHS complaints procedure, which will bring the NHS into line with the wider public sector in Scotland, and a new complaints procedure will be introduced from the 1st of April next year. And I think in part that explains the reason for an increase of inquiries from NHS complaints handlers in terms of what looks like good practice in complaints handling. What will the new complaints procedure look like, and when will it be implemented?
Okay, thank you.
Can I just check some of this conversation, talking about all this new data that we're going to have that we can analyse in the nature of complaints across all public bodies? Is that where the learning and improvement unit comes in when you talk about how Parliament could use some of that information? Could you say a little bit more about that? Because I think what you're saying is we've got huge swathes of data, themes that are emerging over the types of complaints. Local authorities should be analysing that and improving how they handle certain services and functions that they do, so these complaints diminish or don't come in the future, as should health boards, as should other public organisations. Would that be the job of the Learning Improvement Unit to foster some of that? Where would this committee sit as part of that process? Would we be scrutinising? I know it's only 1 year's funding the Learning Improvement Unit got. Is that the kind of unit this committee in the future could scrutinise to see the type of work they were doing to drive some of that change? Could you kind of make it real? What would it actually mean in practice? Because data is wonderful, but it can just sit there and gather dust on a shelf or on a table in an email that was sent to you.
Take that, if that's okay, convener. Yeah, okay. So I think that to make clear, the Learning and Improvement Unit, as John has highlighted, one of the performance indicators that councils have to report against is this issue of demonstrating the learning. And I think that that is the element. Now that we have a standardised process, we have stats available of volumes of complaints, that is the one element of the framework that we see that organisations still genuinely struggle with, about how they can genuinely learn from complaints and how they can demonstrate that learning. So the purpose of the Learning and Improvement Unit is specifically to focus on how do you encourage bodies to actually genuinely learn from complaints. And we're doing that in a number of ways. We did secure funding for a one-year period. We have actually built in funding into our future budgeting to continue the work of that unit. If I can just give you two illustrations of the type of work that small unit of three people will undertake. The first one is that we have never had the resources previously to produce thematic reports. So where of the very small number of complaints that come to the SPSO relative to the whole of the public sector, of those small number of complaints, it is still possible for us to identify some themes and opportunities for learning. So one of the things that unit is doing is identifying and publishing thematic reports. So the first thematic report that will be produced in March of this year, and it's around patients and obtaining consent, because that's a theme where we have seen a number of different types of issues where we feel that we can add some value to the health sector in advice and guidance. So that's one illustration, and we would wish to continue to produce thematic reports. The second area that we are focusing in on is working with a small number of bodies where we can see that they generate either high volumes of complaints or have high uphold rates. And high uphold rates are as a result of not carrying out in-depth, thorough investigation at the late stage of complaints where they've become complex and intractable. And we believe that we can provide some support, some guidance, some further tools and techniques to public bodies when they are in that position.
That's helpful. I'm wondering if at some point in the future we want to give the Learning and Improvement Unit time to bed in, but it might be something this committee might be interested in hearing from directly, because set evidence sessions like this maybe don't give the time to get into detail over some of that stuff, but that's very interesting. Mr. Stewart, do you want to follow up on some of that?
Very apparent that there has been real progress from the role that you play, and also the impact that's having on some of these local authorities and bodies that are being challenged by individuals who feel that they have a grievance to deal with. And to get to the stage that 80% are being managed at local authority. But my question would be about the whole aspect of training and managing the training within these organisations. For complaints officers, for the head of legal departments, for chief executives, to ensure that that is being transmitted across their organisation, to ensure that they can effectively manage complaints as they go forward. There's a role for you to play and for them to play in managing that situation. But at the end of the day, for the complainee, the individual who has the problem, if they do progress to second stage and then they come as far as you, then there's been a real breakdown in some of the communication and some of the training that should have taken place for it to get to that stage. And if you then uphold the situation at your end, then there's been a failure right across the board.
There's a lot in that, Convener. I agree with almost all of that, actually. One of the things that we did, Nikki McLean did actually, was establish a training unit within our office, and that training unit has produced e-learning materials, which are currently now being used across the National Health Service in Scotland with NESS. It's been used by local authorities to train first-line complaint handlers. It's been used in some housing associations and in some further education colleges. It's also been used in higher education in Ireland. It's been used by local authorities in New Zealand, and it has been exported and used without, I believe, credit to us anyway, to the National Health Service in England. That training unit is 0.5 of one person. You can do an awful lot with very little, and I think generally in the public sector in Scotland, we can improve our game by public bodies accepting that it doesn't require a lot of resource to make great improvements. I just add as an aside, Convener, I have argued till I'm blue in the face that Parliament should have given me the right to license that material so that we could make an income from it outside of Scotland, which would have helped to, you know, offset the impacts of having 15% reductions in my budget over 3 years, but that's another issue. So that whole training element is something which is very close to our heart and something that we're working on. Do you want to add to that?
I think just to give a little bit more detail around the types of training that unit delivers, I think, as you rightly say, people at the front line of public services have to have the knowledge, the skills to be able to deal with complaints. But it is also absolutely about the culture and the ability to apologise very, very early on. And we know that if staff have the confidence and the training to do that, that is when you get the early resolution. If they don't, these issues escalate. So we also provide training around the investigation skill stage that I've referred to earlier. But I think that it is quite clear that there is more work to do around the investigation skill stage. But I can't overemphasize the importance of, if the culture within the organization is not there, so staff do not have the confidence, you can train forever and a day and it will make no difference whatsoever.
And you're right, you can train till you're blue in the face, but if there is a nervousness about how the culture is within the organisation, if there's a blame culture potentially, or someone may be scapegoated in the process, and someone may end up losing their role and responsibility because of a situation that occurred, then that has to be taken into the equation. But that has to be managed, because that should be at the forefront to say, well, if we got it wrong, we need to get it right for the future. It's interesting to see that there's an increase across health, because I still think they're very resistant when there's a complaint. They become quite defensive in any I've dealt with across local government and also across the time since I've been here. I have found them to be very defensive when you try to unravel a situation for a constituent that has had a complex complaint. And the frustration from the constituent is that, once again, they are not being listened to because they don't believe that the way they're being treated is in the customer service environment that they would expect.
Mr. Stewart, just before you reflect on comments, particularly about health, it might be good to roll that together, because I know Mr. Simpson wanted to follow up in some aspects of health. So if you're going to give some comments and reflections and Mr. Stewart's contribution, it might be helpful to hear from Mr. Simpson at this point.
Oh, we're up against the clock, Convener, but really just in relation to health, and we've seen that increase in complaints. I wonder if you can give more detail on that. Was there a particular reason for that, or any themes emerging?
I think that the number of health cases which are coming in here compared to when I began as Ombudsman, it's a quite a phenomenal increase in the number of health complaints which are coming to the Ombudsman. The cases which are coming are also more complex now, I think, by and large, than they were before. And health cases often, or almost always, require us to get clinical advice and what have you. They're very, very complex. I think a number of factors are at play. I think people are now more willing to challenge their professions. They're prepared to say to doctors and nurses, I'm not sure that's right. What happened to my family, whatever? Can I have an explanation and to see it through? I think that Mr. Stewart's point about the defensiveness is beginning to recede in health. I think it's beginning to recede. I think one of the areas where health really does need to work, and you will know this, convener, probably from your previous committee life, is that there is still a consultant-led culture in a lot of our larger hospitals where the consultant still thinks of himself as the reigning monarch of their field. And I think that's beginning to break down a bit, and people are coming to us. I think that the kind of areas that we are seeing people bringing us complaints about are roughly the same, although the volume is different. I have to commend Ness and the health boards for the approach that they took post-Francis, the Francis inquiry into mid-Staffordshire hospitals in England. They set about working out how not to have that paragraph in Francis which says that had the chief executive and the chair of that trust listened to the complaints that were coming in and sought to analyse them, many of the deaths there may have been avoided. And they set up working groups and courses on governance for their non-executive directors, for their executive directors and all the rest of it, to try and grapple with that. And I think the Scottish Health Council, moving towards getting a more professional-based health complaint system, which John has helped to have them introduce, will take that a step further. But do you know the most worrying thing for me? Look at the percentage of upholds in health that I'm seeing. I'm seeing 50-odd, 55, 56, 51% year on year. These are all complaints that have been investigated, inverted commas, by health boards. And we're upholding half of them. Now, one of the things I hope will happen from the new complaints process is that the health service will rethink how it approaches these complaints in the first instance, and fewer of them will come to my successor and we'll see a reduction in that uphold rate.
Do you want to follow up on any of that, Mr. Simpson?
I know we're up against the time.
I appreciate that. I know Elaine Smith wants to touch on health as well, then has a final question. So, Elaine, take you now.
Thanks, convener, and thank you all for coming along this morning. On the health, and perhaps it's a question for Nicky McLean, you mentioned your first thematic report on the issue of obtaining informed consent. So I just wondered, I was just looking for a bit more detail on that. Would you, for instance, be hoping that then would encourage improvements? And the thing that springs to mind for me is, for example, it's been in the news recently as the mesh issue for women, and we're now hearing that it can still be used as long as the woman is giving her informed consent for it still to be used. So I'm wondering if this thematic report is going to look specifically at whether or not complaints have been made about whether consent was actually informed and whether it was sought. Is that so? It's quite a specific question about your report.
So we can obviously only report on the complaints that people bring us. So the types of issues that have been brought and will be included. I think there's a case study of about 8 or 9 cases off the top of my head. The types of issues that we see are where things that were minor risks as a result of surgery may have not been explained in detail, where the amount of time given between information being provided and actually medical treatment taking place we felt hasn't been sufficient, and where family members perhaps haven't been involved in the consent process as they should have been. So it's quite a wide range of issues, but it's based on the real case studies that have come to us. And the purpose of it is what we wanted to do from our thematic report is not simply do what other ombudsman schemes have done, which is just put out reports about a particular issue, but we wanted to be able to offer some guidance around that. So we have developed some guidance around if cases do come to the Ombudsman, the types of questions that we would be asking health boards around the consent process and the types of things that we would expect to have seen them to have done. From memory, I don't think we've had any complaints around mesh surgery I can certainly double check that, but it's not an issue that we've seen.
Thanks. And could I briefly go back to, Convener, the special reports? We were discussing this earlier, particularly for Mr. Martin, I think, this question. So if I understand it, you've proposed changes, which I'm sure the committee will be considering. But in terms of special reports, if an authority, assume it's an authority, hasn't made a payment, for example, to an individual, the like of which my colleague Kenny Gibson explained earlier on. So if an authority hasn't done that, what it seems to me is that you're saying that you do have the authority to bring a special report to Parliament, but to date, no special report has been issued. So I suppose I'm wondering why has no special report ever been issued to Parliament? And if and then you're going on to say an organisation that did not want to implement a recommendation could simply ignore it. Could they still ignore it after a special report to Parliament? What would happen if you had issued a special report to Parliament? And what would then be the outcome?
The cheeky answer to that, Convener, is that's a question for you. Because I've been asking for the last 3 or 4 years, maybe 5 years now, for Parliament to come up with a process and procedure of how it would receive a special report. And basically the answer I've got is, don't worry about it, Jim, it'll be all right on the night. We'll deal with it when it happens.
So can I yeah. You wouldn't have issued one because
no.
You don't know what the process is for dealing with it?
We have in the last, I think, 18 months been within a day. You know, in one organisation, we were within a day of going to the Court of Session to require them to give us information that they withheld, because I've got Court of Session powers in order to give evidence. So we've got a public body saying, no, Ombudsman, I am not going to give you the evidence you require for your investigation. And I had to get to the point of saying, well, tomorrow we're in the Court of Session to get it. With others, I've said to them, we're at the point now where we're going to issue a special report, and it's got right down to the wire. And this case we were talking about earlier, which is taking a long time for the recommendation to actually be done, is also that authority. And what's happening here is that the legal departments of some of our public bodies are looking at my legislation and saying, right, how long can we postpone this for? How far can we push this ombudsman to see what he is going to do or is not going to do? Now, my predecessor, Alice Brown, never had to issue a report between 2002 and 2009 because we always got to the brink. I'm at the point where I've always got to the brink, but what I said at the very beginning is I'm seeing a change in culture over the last 2 years where people are playing the system. And that is why I think you have to, as a parliament, you have to understand what you're going to do when my successor brings a special report to you. Where's it going to go? Who's going to deal with it? But also, you've got to give the Ombudsman that bit of power that makes public bodies sit up and take notice.
Thanks, Convener. I suppose I'm just trying to clarify that you're requesting we look at extra power, but I'm trying to clarify what the situation is with not using the power that you actually have at the moment. Yeah. So thank you for that.
Okay. I think it's pretty clear, Mr. Martin, that all the committee members have listened very, very carefully to your appeal for additional powers and processes to be enhanced in relation to special reports, for example, and I have no doubt we will analyse that carefully when we consider the evidence we've had this morning. I think it's only fitting, given this is likely to be our last appearance in front of a local government committee, that we put on record our thanks to yourself, but your wider team as well, for all your work over the years, and we should really give the last word to yourself, Mr. Martin, before we move into private session. Is there anything you would like to add?
Speech.
I was once introduced to speak at a meeting in Glasgow, and the person who was introducing me was not politically on my side, said, we've been very fortunate over the years. We've had a number of very good speakers. Unfortunately, today's speaker is Jim Martin. So I wouldn't say speech too often. No, the one thing I would ask the committee to do, please, is with my successor, give my successor a year or so to have a look at the organisation, to assess the climate in Scottish public services, and then listen to them when they come back and say, this is how I think things can be improved. Because the one thing we don't have, apart from the annual scrutiny of reports, is an area where elected members and the Ombudsman can think and talk strategically off the record about where to take this service. That's the only advice I would give the committee. But thank you very much for hearing me today.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Mr. Martin. Thank you, and Mr. Stevenson and Ms. McLean as well. And we now, as previously agreed, move into private session. Thank you.